Okay, we have a wonderful speaker today, and I was just thinking what to share about Pastor Christina and Pastor Paul. They have been really used by God in 46 nations. I saw 46 nations, a long, many, many nations. I followed them in the Facebook. And you know, one of the things that really, the wonderful proof that really God has blessed them internationally was when they hold their prophetic conference, the annual prophetic conference every year, and you see people coming from all over the world, from Africa, from Asia, from Australia, from India, from all over the world, from Singapore, and you find, wow, people all over the world come for the prophetic conference, and that shows how much respect and honor God has given to them internationally, and they are really, really prophets to the nations, and God has used them mightily. I told you I followed them on Facebook, and I know where you were last week, you know what I mean? And the pictures that you minister, and praise God for them, and they're very, very dear to me and Pastor Lee Chu, because we know them many, many years, and it's a wonderful privilege for SIBKL to cover them wherever they go. They are part and parcel of us, so would you please put your hand together and welcome on the stage Pastor Christina Ang. Amen. Come on, let's give God a wonderful clap offering. They travel all over the world, and whenever they come back to KL, they come and speak to us and give them no rest. Amen.
God bless you. Thank you so much. I believe our church is so awesome because we've got awesome pastors. Amen. Awesome pastors, awesome leaders in this church. Pastor Chu and Pastor Lee Chu are awesome. Amen. Come on. Come on. Yeah, we are so blessed. Thank God. It's all by the grace of God. Amen. Okay, shall we all turn to the Bible? We're going to do some declaration. I know this is healing service, but I realized something about healing. If we just get gifts from God and just go back, the same way we are, we come back sick again. It becomes a routine. So we need to deal with our lives and come and have a look at what we ought to do. Amen? So let's look at Psalm 91. Psalm 91 is a very interesting verse. In a time of calamities that we have, all kinds of diseases, sicknesses, pestilence, all kinds of viruses, epidemics, you know, we can just turn to the Lord, to turn to His Word. It's a foundation for our lives. Let's read together. From verse, I'm going to read it from, New King James Version. Okay, let's read together. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Pause. Let's say it personalized. I dwell in the secret place of the Most High. I shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Verse 2. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. Say, I shall take refuge. Say, the Lord is my refuge. And my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Surely He will deliver me from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He will cover me with His feathers, and under His wings I will take refuge. Let's go on to verse 5. You shall not be afraid of the arrow that flies by day, You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Hallelujah, you believe that? Let's say that to yourself. I will not be, let's say it together, okay? I will not be afraid of the arrow that flies, or the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lay waste at noonday. 1,000 shall fall on my side, and 10,000 on my right hand, but it shall not come near me. Amen. Which means to say, you walk in the streets of KL, you are safe. Only with my eyes will I look and see the reward of the wicked, because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. Amen. Shall we say this? Because I have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, my dwelling place. No evil shall befall me. No plague shall come near my dwelling place. No sickness is my portion. No infirmity is my portion. No, it's not. Healing is my portion. Healing is children's bread. Say, healing is my bread. Healing is my portion. No sicknesses come near me. No infirmities shall touch me. Amen? It's whether you believe God's word or not. Let's go on, verse 11. Why is it so? Because verse 11, for he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all their ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. We carry on. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent. You shall tremble underfoot, because he has set his love upon me. Therefore, I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he knows my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. Amen. God will answer us. I will be with him in trouble. Say, God is with me in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. God's going to deliver us. God's going to honor us. Amen. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Can we say that last verse together? With long life and show him. I happened to compose a song with the Psalm 91. You're going to get them to hear it. Let it just sink to your heart, okay? Thank you.
In the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of his wings. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of his wings. I will say of my God, you are my refuge, my God, in you I'll trust. I will sing of my God, you are my fortress, my God, in you I'll trust. He'll bear you up. And
That's a no evil. Got confused. Never mind. No, it's okay. I think they changed it. Okay, it's really interesting. No evil, no pestilence, no darkness. No. Oh, you, okay. All right, shall we just sing that bridge? No evil, no pestilence, no darkness, no destruction. No pestilence, no darkness, no destruction, no plague, no sicknesses, nothing should find their way in us. You know why? Because we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And because the Holy Spirit dwells within us, amen? We need to have that running into our mind over and over again to understand it. All right. Now I brought me this CD here. It's available outside. A lot of compositions, including Pastor Paul's, and a lot of other compositions are in here. Also, Ash's composition album is here. I also brought. I'm sorry, I'm running very fast. They cannot catch it because I just want to go into the message. Right. We have this prophetic worship conference that's happening in December. And, you know, our church is awesome. Your worship is just awesome. I go a long time and I come back, wow, Larry, you are just awesome. Where's Larry? He is just awesome. Amen? He's superb. Awesome. So the musicians, you're really awesome, and I'm really so happy. And, you know, we have this worship conference going on in December 3rd to 5th. If you're available, it's in Penang. And we also have a ministry mentoring conference. Our Pastor Chu is there as well. Pastor Thomas Chirine is there. And Andres Botta is there. So we're going to have a mentoring conference. And that's going to be held next year. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for all the good things that you're doing. Thank you, Lord, that no evil shall befall us. No plague shall come near our dwelling places. That, Lord, we will say of you, you are our refuge, our fortress. Lord, our God, in you I trust, O God. In you will we trust. Lord, we highly honor your word. Because you, Lord, honor us. You want to deliver us. You, Almighty God, want to honor us. And even grant us salvation. Even send us your Son Jesus, Lord, to die on the cross. Such great honor you have for us. And Lord, we want to thank you for that honor you have given us. And Lord, we want to say, Lord, we honor you too. We want to treasure your word. We want to take you at your word, O God. We know you are a God who will not lie. You are not man that you will lie. You are a God that never lies, O God. I give you thanks, Master. We give you thanks. Lord, sink deep into our hearts how to treasure you, how to treasure your presence so that we will not miss you, Lord. We give you thanks, Lord. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. There are a few things that we found in the psalm that we just read. Firstly, we found that when we dwell in the presence of God, He becomes our refuge. There is a dwelling, there's a staying in. But I took in a few things as I look into the scripture that I felt God is saying to us. In order to treasure God's glorious presence, we need to do something. We need to start us sitting with the Lord and not sitting with people who give us different counsels. We need to start looking to the scripture and seeing the counsel of the Lord in every situation, in every circumstances. In the book of Psalm, chapter 1, the Bible tells us in verse 1 and 2, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sit," look at the word, "sit in the seat of the scornful." You know, for so long, I realized that many of us could be sitting with people who are scornful. The people of this world who don't have got nothing good to say from their mouth. When they open their mouth, they scorn with their mouth. They say all kinds of four-letter words and everything, and we sit among them. And the Bible says, blessed are we, that when we don't partake of that kind of fellowship, we can be friends, we can love them and all, but we don't take in that influence into us. Their words should not penetrate into our system. And we need to come to a place where we take delight in the law of the Lord. You know, the children of Israel, when they were in the wilderness, all the time that they were in the wilderness and the presence of God was there, by day it was the pillar of cloud, by night it was the fire, and the Lord was with them. And you know what? None of them fell sick. Their shoes never grew old. Their clothes, I mean, I don't know, this is a miracle. You know something? They are a walking miracle. The children grow, but their shoe size grow with them. Their clothes don't wither. They don't fall sick. They are well. For 40 years that they stay in the wilderness, God took care of them. In that wilderness where God tried them out. But God took care of them. Isn't that amazing? There's something about the presence of God that causes us to experience divine health. And I'm still learning. And I'm still asking God, God, if you say that be the case, how come Elisha, in the book of 2 Kings chapter 13, he fell sick? And very amazing, it also tells us when he fell sick, he also died. And when he died, let's look at the scripture. Okay, I didn't give them the scripture. I did tell them that sometimes I'll just say scriptures. In 2 Kings in chapter 13, the Bible tells us that Elisha, in verse 14, became sick with the illness of which he would die. All right? I'm not going to the bow and arrow. Go down. And then in verse 20, then Elisha died and they buried him. All right? And then it says here in verse 21, so it was as they were burying a man. Now these raiders came from Moab and they were burying a man. And suddenly they spied a band of raiders and put a man in the tomb of Elisha. And when the man was let down and touched the bones of Elisha, he revived and stood on his feet. Now, Elisha died. His body is like in a state of decay probably. The bones were there. And here was a man they put into the tomb of Elisha. That body touched the bones and he came back alive. That means there was such power in Elisha's bones. And yet he was sick. So there is an avenue there that I cannot answer. Why sometimes is the presence of God so great and yet some people are sick? So we are not in a place of judging. And I like Deuteronomy 29:29. The secret things belongs to the Lord. Amen. The things that are revealed belongs to us and to our children. Amen. So that we may keep the words of the law. Amen. Amen. Deuteronomy 29:29 says that some things is not revealed to us. But on the whole, when we start walking with God, God will deliver us from all kinds of sicknesses. So we do not sit in the seat of the scornful. We rather come and meditate on the word of God and see what God has to say about a situation. When you go through a serious illness and they tell you no hope, you come, sit and meditate. You know what's the word meditate? Meditate is not thinking like that. in the Hebrew word of meditate, it gives you the meaning of the word mutter. Say over and over and over and over. Let it run into your system. That's the word meditate, not just thinking. You know, it's more than that. It's digesting. It's like a cow that digests the grass and takes it in and go again into the system again. Again takes out. And, you know, it's like going over and over and over and trying to get an answer from the Lord. When we seek God and seek Him diligently, the Bible says, the Lord is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. Amen? So we must take an effort. Now, I remember this guy in Genesis chapter 19. I have not given them the notes. Genesis chapter 19, there was this guy and his name was Lot. Now, this Lot was sitting at the gate when the angels came to him. Now, when you sit in those days, sit at the gate, that means to say you are like an elder, you are in a place of counsel, you give counsel and advice, you sit at the gate. And this is not an ordinary city, this is the city of Sodom. And as he was sitting at the gate, he was in eldership, he was part of the society. The Bible says two angels came. Do you know why the two angels were sent? In the previous chapter, the Lord said in his heart, in Genesis 18 verse 17, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do? God was about to destroy Sodom because of the iniquity that is in that city. But Lot, the nephew of Abraham, was seated in that place of honor in that city. He was part and parcel of the masyarakat of that city. How did he come to that place? What was the history behind Lot? The Bible tells us in Genesis chapter 13, when the land could not contain Abraham and Lot anymore because God blessed them so much in Genesis chapter 13. And both the herdsmen of Abraham and the herdsmen of Lot started to quarrel because that's not enough space. And so Abraham told Lot, no, let's not have strife. If you go to the north, I go to the south. You go to the right, I go to the left. You just choose whatever place you want so that we will not strive. The Bible says in verse 10 of Genesis 13, Lot lifted his eyes and saw all the plains of Jordan, and it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt as you go towards Zoar. And the Bible says that Lot chose that place because it looks good. It looks good on the outside. The Bible says in verse 13, but the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. But Lot did not see that the inhabitants of the land is going to have a great impact, influence over his family. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 19 that he was seated in the place of honor among these exceedingly wicked and sinful people. And it was so great was their sin, the Bible tells us when he told the daughters and the sons-in-law who had married those daughters to come, leave the city because God says he's going to destroy, they all mocked at him. They were unbelieving people. The children have gone in. You know, when Abraham pleaded to the Lord in Genesis 18, and I hope I'm not going too fast. I try to slow down. But Abraham pleaded with the Lord, don't destroy Sodom. He says, if there's 100 people, will you destroy? God says, for you, there are 100 righteous people, I won't destroy. If there are 50 righteous people, will you destroy? God says, okay, for your sake, 50 righteous, I won't destroy. Lord, please don't be angry with me. If there are 25 righteous people, will you destroy? And the Lord says, okay, 25 for your sake, 25 righteous people, I won't destroy. Lord, if there's 10 righteous people, God could not find 10 righteous people. Someone once told me, God loves the sinner. But actually, that is not so correct. God so loved the world. It's a general, God loves everybody. God loves the world. But if a person knows the Lord, he knows the truth, and purposely turns his back, don't tell me God loves him. I'll give you scripture otherwise. Come with me to Proverbs in chapter 3, verse 32. For the perverse person is an abomination to the Lord. When a person is perverse, when a person is forward, the Bible says it's an abomination to God. But his secret counsel is with the upright. God wants upright people to be. Amen. I believe this church has got upright people. God wants righteousness to reign. Amen. God gives us his word. He loves us. He honors us. He treasures us. We receive his word. We receive his sacrifice at the cross, but we should treasure what he says in his word. Jesus said, if you don't keep my commandment, you don't love me. If you love me, you will keep my commandment. So don't tell me that God loves a sinner, so I can do all the sin I want. I know God hates the sin, but God loves the sinner. I think this is a big deception from the pits of hell. In Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 16, there are six things that the Lord hates, and seven are abominations. See, what happens when you have pride? You become a prideful person, and God does not like it. When you start talking lies, you become a liar. It becomes part and parcel of you. A person who constantly watch pornographic movies and pictures, allow the spirit of lust to come in. He has a partnership. Is this making noise? Am I too loud or something? It's okay, yeah? Is he having a partnership, being a harlot with the spirit of lust? He becoming one with the spirit of lust. And when he becomes one with the spirit of lust, what happens? When God looks at you, he doesn't see you. He sees the spirit of lust and he hates it. Because you have become one with the spirit of lust. You become a lustful person. Sometimes we make God very cheap and his love very cheap. If that be the case, do you know in hell there are many Christians? More important than your healing is your salvation, and you start walking right with God. You know, when I'm talking about Lot, and you know, when my son was just got his visa, I cried. Because at that moment, I also came to know that America sanctions same-sex marriage. So I really cried. I said, God, are we doing the right thing? And I brought this whole scripture about Lot, and I told Lord, are we doing the wrong thing? Are we like sending my son to a place where people are wicked? And I was in a way, in a time, lost at that moment. I said, God, tell me. And suddenly the Spirit of God just rested in my heart and told me, the place that you're sending your son is a good place. And then he brought me to remember what happened in the early months of this year. What actually happened was, you know, when you do the SAT exam, then you got to give 5 universities or 6 universities. And I was being ambitious because initially I just wanted to do law, so I put Yale, Harvard, and I don't know what other universities, putting some of those universities in there. Then my sister told me, Dallas Baptist University is an awesome university. It's very good. She got first class honors from there. So she says, it's very, very good. So I said, okay, I'll choose that. And then another one, Northwestern or something. And 3 universities replied. And one of them was the Ivy Leagues, which replied. And I went and looked. Of course, the price was super high. But then I went and looked at what they teach under political science. Because when you do law in America, you have to do another degree. And then you do law. If you do medicine, you've got to do another degree. That's related. So then I looked into that, what they would teach in political sciences. And one of the subjects that's very important is social science. I went to look at the modules. What do they teach in social sciences? And I saw same-sex marriage ideology. I told myself, how could I give my 17-year-old son to learn such thing? I will not let that kind of ideology go in. Parents, before you send your children, especially if they're young, go search out what subject, what are they teaching? I went into the modules of Dallas Baptist University and I saw it was pretty good. One of the important subjects that he has to learn in every year was DCM, is Developing Christian Mind, is a compulsory subject. So that's super good, am I right? So I'm glad that I heard the Lord and sent him to a right place. Amen? Also not so expensive, other universities, super, super expensive. So this is something for you all to know. And how I came to know this is also because Asher was in a Alpha Omega Academy. Now, if you have children that you're keen to go online studies, since my son has already done it, I can just tell you, go www.aoacademy and go and look into that website and see if there's anything that interests you about for your children's further studies, all right? I mean, especially if they want to go the higher grades and 9, 10, 11, 12. Go and search that out. So the thing is, about this is they have a parents group as well, and the parents group, we talk to each other. So Asher has got his group. I can see all of Asher's work, how much is completed in my handphone. All right, everything comes in. The school always relate with me. Everything I can see in my handphone. He can never lie to me. He doesn't lie, but the child can never lie. The other thing that happens is that the parents, teachers will discuss, we exchange notes. And one of the things I found out in America is this. The conservative Christians, the righteous Christians, try not to send their children to the secular universities. They send them to the Christian universities. I found that out from the friends, from the parents. So we need to, why I'm saying all this is because many of us parents don't realize that we've sent our children to school and the children are under somebody's care for 8-9 hours a day. You actually do not know them every day. When you see them, you spend 2 to 3 hours with them. You have not imparted anything to them. Then you come back and tell me, why is my son, why is my daughter gone wayward? Because we as parents have to impart. You know what's so beautiful about Abraham? In Genesis 18, the Lord had this very high regard for Abraham. I'll just look at that, all right? Genesis 18. Verse 17, and then goes on to verse 19. 17 was when the Lord says, shall I hide from Abraham what I'm doing? Genesis 18 and verse 19. Verse 19, this is what God said. For I have known Abraham. I have known him in order that he may command. It's not for teachers to command. It's not for Sunday school teachers to command. It's parents, we command our children and our and his household after him, and that they may keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him. We must bring the presence of God, not just in the church, in our home. If the presence of God is in our home, the presence of God will increase in the church. Amen? We must start coming back to the basics where parents instruct their children in the ways of the Lord. And God says, I know Abraham. I know this man. He will do that. God has entrusted lives into our hands. And so we treasure the lives. I only got one nation, one person. Some of you got four nations. God doesn't look at two children, three children. God look at nations that God has given you. Amen? If you've got four nations you have. Four children is four nations. Amen? God see the descendants of them that walks with righteousness before God. So we need to start coming back to this part where we start sitting in the counsel of God. Our families sit in the counsel of God. And this is so important if we don't want our children to fall into wrong teachings, in deceptions, into lies of the devil. We have to build our hedge around our home well. Have I made myself clear? Secondly, we need to stand. Where you stand is very important. If you want a miracle, you want the presence of God, your standing is a statement. The Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 17, when Elijah came before King Ahab. He said, there shall not be dew except at my word. But he said something else. He says that he stands in the presence of God. That means he stands in his private life when nobody is watching, when no eyes are upon him, when nobody knows about him, his existence. He's there in a private place and he's standing in the presence of God. He's having an encounter with God, and no trumpets, no sound, nobody knows about it. But when he comes out, there is miracles. We find in Daniel 10, I think it's verse 12, where the angel came to Daniel and began to tell Daniel. Daniel chapter 10. Actually, that's going on to the next point, but never mind. We'll just carry on. Daniel chapter 10. And in verse 12, verse 12. Okay. We go to Luke first. Daniel's is a different point. Sorry, I just got carried away. Now, we find in Luke chapter 1, when Zechariah, okay, that word so hard is another point. When the angel came and visited Zechariah, there's one thing that the angel said, that he came from the presence of God. He stood in the presence of God. When angels stand, when men of God, when women of God stand in the presence of God, it's a statement. Come with me to the book of Ephesians in chapter 6. How are we to stand? When we go through an evil day, we don't crumble. When you go through a bad day, you don't crumble. You stand because you are a warrior. You make a statement. That's why you stand. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, the Bible tells us that therefore take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand. Say withstand. In the evil day. There is an evil day plotted out, ambushed for each one of us. When you hear a bad news, you may all come together. It's an evil day planned out to make you crumble, to make you break down. I was just reminded of a story that just recently happened when I was in Brunei. And this woman, she's an awesome preacher. She's fantastic. And her husband just wanted to support her. And all of a sudden, in September, he felt like he got a tummy ache. He felt sick. And they were trying to find out what's wrong and trying to get him well. And there was some complication. Actually, it should not be a complication, but there was some complication in the hospital where they tied up the colon or something wrongly, and it became septic. Became septic, and he got shocked. The body went through a shock at septic, and he died. And she was a pastor of the church in Brunei, so she was trying to get all these organized. Went to Bandar, where her husband and all was, I mean, their hometown was, and they tried to get everything sorted out. And as they were staying in her sister's house, she said, all of a sudden, a snake came into the house. I mean, the husband is in the mortuary. They're trying to work things out of the hospital. And here there was a snake. And the snake came in. And everybody screaming, all our girls. And they all are screaming. And she didn't know what to do. So they all said, you must do something. Because, wow, the one standing on the... And the snake heard all the screams, went under the cupboard and was staying there. So she went upstairs. And they told her that there's got this, you know, the weight, lifting weight stuff. And so she decided, I'm going to can't throw books or anything, must kill that snake. How to kill? No man in the house. Try to call, no man is coming. Only these girls, three ladies. And so what she did was, she brought this huge weight. So now she said, I don't know how I carry the weights down the steps. And so the other girl was supposed to take a long stick and hit the snake. The snake will come out and must drop. So she must stand in the right place to drop. The first drop missed, second drop, she got it right on the head. And she whack, 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 whack the head. You cannot come into my house anymore. And after that, she was driving back to Kuala Lumpur. Her car burst into flames. Thank God, she stopped the car at a place where it will not affect another person. The whole car burst. All during that time, the funeral is not over yet. So one after another, things happened, and she could not understand. She was telling me, I cannot understand. Then after that, she came back to her house. After the whole funeral is over, she's trying to open the door, wondering why the key doesn't work. And lo and behold, we found out that the whole house was robbed. One after another. You know, sometimes when the enemy attacks, they attack like that. She asked me, what did I do wrong? I'm preaching the word. I do. I said, no, it's just an attack. I said, you got to stand. Something is there to break you so that you won't press on. Because God is working in your life. There's an anointing in your life. So I encourage her. My friends, we have to stand. We have to withstand. Don't sit on your laurels. We are in a war. If you do not know you are a soldier, you better know today you are a soldier. Some of the sicknesses and illness come to you to break you down so that you will not go further. Amen? So we have to fight. We have to fight or wage a good warfare. The Bible says that we have to withstand. Having done all, we have to withstand. And having done all, to stand. The Bible talks about standing our ground and not giving up. We also need to stay in the presence of God. I didn't give them that notes. We have to stay in the presence of God. The presence of God brings tremendous blessing. Come with me to the book of 2 Samuel and chapter 6. You know, in 2 Samuel chapter 5, David was made king over all of Israel. The first thing he did, that he wanted the presence of God. But they did not know how to handle the presence of God. They handled it callously. And because of that, Uzzah was struck. And so the presence of God was put into the house of this man called Obed-Edom in verse 10. And when the ark of the Lord, the ark of God is what I call the presence of God, right? Was in the house of Obed-Edom. The Bible says God blessed Obed-Edom and his whole household. My friends, today the ark of the covenant is in us. The Bible says that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We have to treasure the ark, the presence of God. If we don't treasure and take the presence of God lightly, then the enemy comes and continue to harass us. Some of the sicknesses and diseases we have is because we have disregarded the presence of God. We disregarded this body. You thought it's your body. I can do what I want. It's my body. No, it's not your body. This body belongs to the Lord Jesus Christ. Our bodies are the temple. You're not your own. You're bought with a price. Can I take one more scripture? Book of John. 1 John. 1 John. And are you all enjoying this? Do you all like the word of God? Yeah. In the book of 1 John, I want to say this very clearly, that we begin to understand that we don't play with sin. In verse 4, whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. 1 John 3, verse 4. And then let's go on. Verse 7. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. I want us all to read it. I don't know what version you have in verse 8. He who sins is of the devil. Who said it? Who said it? The scripture. Which means to say, my friends, we've got to start walking with God and stop sinning purposefully. One time I was in a particular state. I'm not going to mention because I realized my thing is broadcasting as well. I was in a particular state and I was ministering there. Suddenly I turned and I saw this young boy. And I told him that, I went to him and said, is it true that you want to commit suicide? He shook his head. Then I left it. Then I made an altar call for those who were having, some of the students there said they were going into, computer games and all that stuff for hours. I said, you need to be released and let God come into your life and not worship computer games. Some of them 5-6 hours. So finally they came and this boy came up. And after the whole thing was over, I prayed for him. Again, the Lord prompted my heart. He wanted to commit suicide. I asked him again quietly. He shook his head. That happened that night. It happened to be a birthday party of that boy. Isn't it? God has a way of dealing with people. That night, there was a birthday party for that boy. And we were upstairs. And the mom came to, mom was standing behind the boy. Mom said, come here, boy. Showed me all the cuts that's in the boy's hand. And how he wanted to kill himself. You know why? He keeps going into these games. He's going in the realm of the demon spirits, in the escapism realm. There's no free realm. In the world, it's either darkness or light. If you go into an empty world, it's not empty, actually, it's demon spirits. They come and grab you. And you know, he was delivered that day. And the pastor showed me the cyber cafe. And in the cyber cafe, there's so many students. 11 o'clock in that night, we were leaving that place. And students were there in the cyber cafe, busy, busy, busy on a game. My friends, we need to start dealing with all these issues in our life. Start walking in righteousness. This is a time when the enemy comes to steal the next generation. We cannot allow the enemy to steal our families, steal our children, steal our kinfolk, amen. Steal our lives, even. If you've got unforgiveness, you've got things in your life that need to settle, don't say, God forgives me, because God loves the sinner. I already showed you a sin that sins is an abomination to the Lord. God looks at the sin, and the sin overwhelms you. But if you come to God, and you ask God to forgive you, and the blood of Jesus cleanses you, God looks at you, and he sees the forgiveness at the cross. He sees Jesus on you. We need to have Jesus on us, his blood covering us, not sin overwhelming us. Amen. Amen. We can be in church, and yet it could be that. We could be struggling with habits. I want to say something. There is no habit that God cannot deliver. God can deliver you from every habit. All that you need to do is cry out to the Lord. This poor man cried out, the Bible says, and the Lord delivered him out of all his troubles. God will deliver you out of all your troubles, whether it's sicknesses, whether it's sin, whether it's whatever trouble. God is a faithful God. He will deliver you. Amen. We got to cry out to God and receive it and change. Purposefully change. Someone once said to me, I don't know how to change. I keep falling back. Simple. God is everywhere, right? You believe. Say, Lord, I'm in this situation. I need help. One day I was taken by the Spirit. Okay, please excuse me. My language I'm using. Please excuse me. But I don't know how. I was in my bedroom. I was praying. I found myself in some other place. I found myself in a hotel room. All of a sudden. And I'm standing at the door of the hotel room. And if this is the door, this is the bathroom, the bed is there, and there was a huge angel standing there with a record book in his hand. And I have word of knowledge in a few things. Number one, that man who was there was actually a Christian, a leader, and he's a Christian, and he's sinning against God, and he's taken account. And bang, I went back. I said, God, what is this all about? And the Lord says, many people think that when they do things in private, nobody knows. Heaven is a cloud of witnesses, the Bible says. We are never alone. We are never alone. When you think you're alone, you are never. There's a cloud of witnesses watching you. Powers of darkness watching when to trap you. God is watching when to deliver you. And we need to go to God and be delivered. If you have a sin, you have a sicknesses in your life, God is here to deliver you. This is not a message to condemn. This is a message to deliver you so that we will start walking right. Because the days that we are living in are evil days. Are bad days. Darkness will grow darker, but we who walk with the Lord will shine brighter. It's going to be good days for us. It's going to be wonderful days. The harvest is ripe. Amen. And many souls are going to come. The harvest is ripe in Malaysia. It's super ripe. Many souls, amen. Souls are waiting to be won into the kingdom. But we have to start walking right. I do not know how else to tell you this. God wants us to walk right. Come back to the Word. Come back. Stop taking God, as the television said. Stop taking God, reading when you like it. Musicians. You know, there's this scripture in Genesis and chapter 4. It talks about this man called Cain. Cain came to the Lord, and he brought an offering from the ground to the Lord. Then Abel came along, and he brought the firstlings of the flock with their fat and brought to the Lord. If you read the scripture very carefully, you'll find the Bible says, the Lord respected Abel and his offering, but God did not respect Cain and his offering. There was something about Abel. He treasured God. He gave God the best, everything of his best. And there was huge respect and honor from God. When the presence of God falls, it's God's honor. God is honoring you. God is honoring me. I do not know what kind of illness you go through, but God's honor is upon you. God's presence is upon you. Do not be like Cain. God spoke to Cain and says, Cain, if you do well, will you not be accepted? But Lord, sin lies at the door, and his desire is to have you. Amen. This same situation goes on throughout the generation. The enemy wants to get us, but we will want heaven. We must choose heaven. Not choose heaven in church, choose heaven in your car when you're driving. Stop screaming and shouting and the person overtake you, but choose heaven in your car. Put on our worship CDs, they are beautiful. Get the presence of God into your car. Choose heaven in your private places, in your marriage, in your family. Come back, have a family prayer with your family. That is important. God wants that to be established. The house of Obed-Edom was blessed because the ark of the Lord was in that place. If you want to be blessed, you want your healing, you want your deliverance, you receive the presence of God. Run after the presence of God. That's where your breakthrough is. That's where your healing is. You believe that? It's a beautiful song, Heaven's Blessing. Could you just play that? Rufina sang the song. It's beautiful. It's written by a Filipino girl who's part of us. You can sing along. Never mind. You can catch it.
Lifting up my eyes,
presence.
Lifting up my eyes, I see you.
Spirit of God, search your heart. Maybe you don't have an illness and sickness, but maybe you have a habit. Maybe your private life is an abomination to God and you know it. You need to start to set your life right, because we do not know the days that we are living in. Tomorrow, we do not know whether we can be alive tomorrow when we walk out of this place. We do not know whether today is the last day of our life. We do not know. We really do not know. Things can happen suddenly to us. A friend that I know, very good health, perfect health, fantastic. And all of a sudden, a truck dashed his car and he died on the spot. We do not know. We do not know. We need to value the days that we have. I know this is a healing service, but your soul needs healing. Your life needs a healing. Your private life needs a healing. And God is a restoring God. I'm not going to call you and ask you to come up here and confess your sin, but right where you are, wherever, I know some of you are too shy, but just stand wherever you are. Let the place that you stand be holy ground. Just be real before God and says, God, I blew it. I'm sorry. I'm weak, but you are strong. Hold me. Deliver me. Cry out to God wherever you are. The presence of God is here. Can deliver you. As we sing this chorus again, just cry out to God. I can see someone crying far out. God is just touching you right now. God is delivering you right now. Doesn't matter where, how far you've fallen, God is there to deliver you, but you must come back.
Yeah.
power of God is in this place to deliver you. If you want hands to lay on you, you can come here. But if you want to receive your healing and you know God is doing something to you, just stand where you are and receive that breakthrough right now. But if you want hands to lay on to you, come to the front and we will pray for you. But you want the Lord to touch you wherever you are, just lift up your hands where you are. The Bible says that we got to say, whatever we say with our mouth, what happens. In Mark 11, verse 23, 24 says that if you would say to the mountain, be removed and cast into the ocean, it's done. You have what you say. Lord, we believe, Lord, the words that would proceed from our mouth. We have what we say, God. In Daniel 10 verse 12, the angel came because of the prayer. The first day that our words were uttered, Lord, you would come. Lord, I just thank you right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. We declare, we speak into the bodies of God's people, Lord. We command the organs that are not good to become good in the name of Jesus. To become good right now in the name of Jesus, wherever you are. Receive that breakthrough right now in Jesus' name. And I speak into the bones right now. The bones to be healed right now. Every part of the bone marrow, right where the blood is. In the name of Jesus, I thank you for the healing in the blood. Every disease in the blood, I command you in the name of Jesus to leave. You got no right, you got no place, because our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit of God rests upon us. In the name of Jesus, say amen. Say my body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Sickness, you got no right to stay in my body. Growth, you got no right to stay in my body. No diseases in my blood, in the name of Jesus. I speak to my blood. You are healed in Jesus' name. You are healed. Speak to your body. Say to it, you are healed. You break through in Jesus' name. I receive my healing. I receive my breakthrough. I give you thanks, Lord. I give you thanks, Lord. The Bible says we have what we say. Father, we give you thanks, Lord. The worlds were framed by the word of God. We were made in the image and the likeness of God, so that we can speak, we can command in Jesus' name, and it's done. Lord, we thank you that you highly exalted your name, O God, and even your word above your name. And so, Lord, we receive that breakthrough. We thank you for the power in the name of Jesus. And anyone, Lord, who got illness and diseases in this place, Lord, it doesn't matter what the doctor says. They are mechanics. Lord, they are just mechanics, Lord. But you are the manufacturer, Lord. You are the one who created us. You are the creator. You got the spare parts with you, Lord. And so, God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we receive the spare parts. Receive your new heart. Receive your new lungs. Receive your new kidney in Jesus' name. Receive it. Say, I receive it. Say, I receive it. As you say with your mouth, the angel will come and give that to you. Yes, as you say it, as you believe it, the first day you cry out, you say, I receive. It's yours. Say, I receive. It's yours.
Expect it to go beyond the usual time. actually the anointing increases towards the end. So if you don't have to rush, don't rush, because you miss it. And I know in my spirit that today God wants to heal you holistically. Don't only come for physical healing. God wants to heal your heart. God wants to heal your mind. There are people here who have got problems in their mind. They can't sleep. Their imaginations run wild. Sometimes you think that things are not right. You can't control your thoughts. You know that. You're at the edge. You may be stressed out. I don't know. But God also wants to control your soul. Whatever it is, you know. And there are certain areas of your life that are not right with God. So God wants to heal you holistically. So I'm going to give the altar call. Honestly, I just feel that even as you come out, take a step of faith, including physical illness. I want to believe that the word of God has gone forth. I'm not going to leave it just like it is. Just receive it. Take it at face value, understand? That's the word of God. It's hard, but I believe that because anointing of God is in this place, such messages gain traction in this church. Another place, maybe not. But because the presence of God is here to heal and to make whole the body of Christ here, take it seriously as you come forward. Whatever your issue may be, that will be broken. But if you walk out of this place and think, oh, another service, it will hold on to you for the rest of your life. Whatever it is, could be a habit, it could be a mindset, it could be a sickness, it could be something that affects your mind. I don't know, it could be unforgiveness, it could be offenses. It will hold on to you, follow you out. But even as you come forward, you leave it here and you walk out a free man. So it's up to you. So we're going to sing this song again. I know the time is going out, but you know the miracles of God don't follow the clock, one. No? The miracles of God do not follow the clock. I just know in my spirit that this is what the Lord wants, and you take it or you leave it. So we're going to sing the song. If there's any one of you with whatever your issues may, you just run forward, and I believe that whatever it is, the whole you will be broken. Those one who left, let them go, understand? But praise God, you stayed. You stayed. You stayed. So when you stay, leave your sin behind. Leave your sickness behind. You go out a healed man, a free man. Don't carry that with you out. This is your chance. Amen. We're going to sing this song again, and the altar is open. Amen. Let's sing this song. Lift the eyes. Amen. Hallelujah. The anointing of God is here. The word has gone forth. You leave your sickness behind. It doesn't matter who prayed for you. It's God. Understand? It's God. That curse will be broken. That hindrance will be taken off. That sickness will be gone. That habit will be broken. That whatever it is that holds you will be left here in this church. You will walk out a free man. You will walk out a free man. Amen. Whoa.
See that you are there, lifting up my hands. I feel you everywhere. I will worship you in spirit and in truth.
One more time, lifting up your eyes, lifting up your eyes. Look to Jesus, look to Jesus. He's your healer, church. He's your healer, not man. Jesus is going to set you free. Jesus is going to heal your mind. Jesus is going to heal your heart. Jesus is going to heal your body. Amen. One more time. Let's sing it. Let's sing it. A beautiful song. Beautiful song. Leave it your right.
I will worship.
somebody pray, make sure there's somebody behind you. Make sure there's somebody behind you. Just stay still in the presence of God. Will you do that? Let the presence of God work, all right? We don't hype things. Honestly speaking, I'm not here to hype things. I've lived long enough to know. If God is here, God is here. If God is not here, no matter how you hype it, God is not here. Understand? But I know God is here. God is here. And there's certain things in your life, in my life, that needs to be seen, even on the stage. For those of you on the stage, I don't know. Up here. Same. I know that this is not an ordinary healing service. God is giving you and me a chance to break out and break through before the year is out. So that when we walk out of this place, we walk out a free man in space and in time. You don't only walk out of this place as free man in terms of space, in other words, location, but also in time for the rest of your life. That's why I say God is no respecter of clock. You just stay where you are. Oh, Ramanda kata da 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 da. Oh, just trust God, church. Just trust God. Oh, Ramanda kata da 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 da. Wherever you are, just trust God. If you're too embarrassed to come forward, wherever you are standing, will you turn? Wherever you are standing into an altar, will you do that, church? We are not here for show, understand? I'm not here for show. You just trust God to break out and break through. Whatever your situation is, nothing is impossible with God, understand? You know that you are entangled in that for a long, long time. God wants to excavate you out of that mud, out of that dung, out of that feces, out of that excrement, so that you can breathe again, fresh air, and be a free man. So that no burden will weigh you down for the rest of your life. You are a free man. You are a free man. You are a free woman. Oh, Ramanda kata da 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 shanda kata da 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 mata. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Ramanda kata da 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 shanda kata da Ramanda kata da 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 da. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just soak in the anointing of God. Will you do that? Just soak in the anointing of God. Just wherever it is, just soak in. Even if you are standing there, you just delight in the presence of God. Understand? Just delight. You don't even have to do anything. Just open your heart, open your life. Just confess your sins. That's all there is. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us all our sins. It's amazing, it's all our sins, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's not half, it's not 30%, but 100%. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of all our sins and to cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. Amen. Oh, Ramanda Kata, will you do that? Will you soak in the presence of God? Will you just confess our sins before Him and receive the forgiveness of God? Receive the forgiveness of God over your life. Oh, Ramanda kata da 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 da. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Oh, Ramanda, I'm going to dismiss you. If you want to go, you go. But you want to come, you stay, all right? Father, in Jesus' name, I want to thank you for your word that has gone forth. Father, Lord, even as your anointing continues in this place, may we continue to bask, Lord, under the blessedness of your anointing, because we are safe in you. You are here to heal us. You are the great healer. You are the one who make us whole, not only heal us physically, but to make us whole, Father, Lord. The word whole is sozo, so that salvation will come in its fullness. Salvation and deliverance, sozo, will come in His fullness, Father Lord, so that we receive the full blessing of the sozo of God, the sozo of God that will permeate through our mind, our body, our heart, our emotions, our soul, so that we are made a free man from inside out and outside in. Oh, hallelujah, we receive it. We receive it. We receive it this night. We receive it. We walk out, Father Lord, leaving our sins behind. We walk out, leaving our sicknesses behind. We walk out, leaving our offenses, our unforgiveness, our insomnia, every mental thing, all things we leave behind, and walk out with the fullness of the Holy Spirit within us, Lord. In the fullness of joy, in the fullness of life, into the abundant life that You promised us. Oh, Father, we receive it with thanksgiving. Receive it with thanksgiving. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, God.